Blackstone Audiobooks presents Bone of Contention by Roberta Gellis. Prologue. Spring 1134, near Cullum. Carl Butcherson quietly followed after the maidservant he'd been futtering toward the small grassy clearing where her mistress was waiting for her. The maid was a tasty piece, but he had an appetite for sweeter, softer flesh. If he could catch the maid's mistress in the indiscretion the maid had confessed to him, the mistress might well spread her legs for him to keep her secret. If she coupled with one, why not with two? He heard his doxy cry out in surprise or pain and wriggled quickly to where he could see. He expected to get a fillip of pleasure from seeing the girl beaten because he had made her late. But what he did see made his breath catch in his throat. Him! He had seized the maid and was holding her with her back to him, and he saw what was at the maid's feet. Carl would have torn himself free of the bushes to run away, but he was paralysed with fear, and so he saw the man's hand rise and plunge down, saw a long knife dripping red emerge from the maidservant's throat, saw the blood fountain down her breast, saw the man push the girl so she fell forward, next to the other body, the body so battered about the head that he would not have known her except for her fine gown. Carl choked back a cry of terror and began to squirm backward out of the ring of brush. As he freed himself, the killer turned his head. Carl leapt to his feet and ran and ran and ran until he could run no more. Then he found a place to hide, and he lay still, first shivering with fear, but when he realised no one was following or searching for him and his terror eased, thinking. He lay hidden all night and did not return home. The next day he ran again right out of Cullum. He had a friend in Sutton who could teach him how to defend himself. 4 years later, spring 1139, Oxford. A shadow shifted in the niche in the attic that funnelled sound from the comfortable solar below. The man crouching there had discovered, by accident, that a strange quirk of the construction or some crack that formed in the settling of the building produced the effect. 2 feet away, one could not hear a thing, but just here, everything his master said in his private solar could be heard clear as a church bell. The shadow in the niche had almost forgotten that he had once been Carl Butcherson, until the voice of the man who had unintentionally given him his new life reminded him of everything. He breathed in deeply but silently. How fortunate that the man should come to his attention here, not far from the manor where a local but powerful baron likely still mourned a murdered daughter and sought her killer. No greater impulse moved Carl to betray the murderer now than he had felt when he saw the maid stabbed and her mistress lying dead. He only felt that he finally had a desire important enough to extort a favour from the killer. Also, he thought, smiling grimly, he was no longer a terrified, simple butcher's son. He was a practised man-at-arms who had no need to fear the killer's strength. He crouched, still as death, hardly breathing, while civilities were exchanged between his master and the murderer. Those civilities told him where the man now lodged and to whom he was sworn. He could find him when he needed him. Now he had a tool that would deliver to him the rich orphan his master and the king's clerk had been talking about a few days ago. Carl was growing uncomfortable and would have left then, but the men were too close to the opening that carried the sound. Perforce he heard his master say, "We know that treason is intended, but it is too dangerous to wait until there is a proof of that. We must find a cause to strip them of their power before they act." The murderer then made a suggestion, and his master laughed. "It's certainly worth a try," his master said. "If it happens early enough, it will be an irritation, even if it does not succeed, and we will have time enough to try again." "Oh, it will succeed, my lord," the killer said. "If you will suggest to the king's steward that the lodging provided for his retainers be inadequate and uncomfortable, and very near some foreign lord who has more space than he needs." There was a sly suggestiveness in the voice. "I do not—" his master began uncertainly, and then burst out laughing. Carl heard the scritch of a chair's legs against the floor, and then his master's voice fading as he moved away. "But I do. I do know the perfect victim to be abused." Carl Butcherson listened idly, learning the name of the lord whose men were to be used. However, as soon as he realized that the plans would not involve his master's troops and so were irrelevant to him, he lost interest. It was more important to escape from his profitable oubliette before someone heard him. He had all the information he needed. Chapter 1. 15th of June, Old Priory Guest House. The thin, dark man, in correct, if unusually sumptuous, priestly garments, nodded briskly at the hall.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.